Yeah, very good morning to all my dear students. Those who are appearing for November 2015 CAIPCC exam, here is a quick revision on the amendments that have happened by Finance Act 2014 and the amendments which have taken place 6 months before exam, that is up to 30 April. You must have read these amendments by now, but the intention of this video is to give you a quick revision on the amendments which are very important from exam point of view. This is Guzar Krishna. I am a faculty at WSCI Academy. I have taught more than 8,000 students last 6 years, and my students have made us proud by securing exemptions in our subjects and securing All India ranks. So I am pleased to give this video to those students who are unable to attend our offline classes and they are in need of amendments. So the main intention of this video is to address such students. So we would start with the direct tax today, and we would come up with another video on the indirect taxes. So to start with, this is a quick revision on first chapter, that is tax rates. This has lot of significance because you will be computing your compulsory question 10 marks, so you should know how the tax rates are. So I will repeat all the basics which you know. The basic exemption limit is 2.5 lakhs, but if it is resident senior citizen 60 years or more, then it is 3 lakhs, and for super senior citizen 80 years or more, it is 5 lakhs. Nothing changed when compared to surcharge. It is the same. Surcharge is applicable at the rate of 10% if income exceeds 1 crore. And when it comes to rebate under section 87 capital A, yeah, rebate is also the same what you have already studied. It is applicable for resident individuals, and we know what is the condition for rebate. The income should not exceed 5 lakhs. It can be less than or equal to 5 lakhs. And the amount of rebate is rupees 2000 or income tax liability, whichever is lower. And marginal relief is also the same. So this is done, your income tax liability. Please remember, basic exemption limit is 2.5. So let us move on to the next chapter. So we would discuss amendments chapter wise. So income from house property, as we all know, the interest limit under section 24 small b has been enhanced from rupees 1.5 lakhs to 2 lakhs. And this limit is applicable for self-occupied house property. So please remember, when you're solving problem under section 24b, interest deduction is no more 1.5, it is 2 lakhs. Coming to the next chapter, PGBP, this has undergone many amendments, and we can expect one exam question from here. You are already familiar with section 32AC. It was introduced by Finance Act 2013 to encourage investment in manufacturing sector. 32AC initially came up with the condition that you should be investing in plant and machine more than 100 crores in 2 financial years. But this section got revised by Budget 2014, and it is good news for the manufacturers. The condition is no more 100 crores, it is only 25 crores. So now you need to remember, under section 32AC 1A, you will get 15% deduction on the actual cost of machine, provided the investment is 25 crores or more in the financial year. And this 32AC 1A is applicable for 3 financial years, 14, 15, 15, 16 and 16, 17. So let me summarize. Initially they had introduced 32AC, but the condition was 100 crores. Then 32AC 1A had come, which has made the condition 25 crores. But for financial year 14-15, you have to read the sections together and accordingly give deduction. Further, if you move on to PGBP, there is another good news in section 35AD. Initially, only 11 types of business were covered under specified business list. But now, 2 more business got added here. But the deduction is only 100%. So you all know that 5 lakhs of business are eligible for 150% deduction. But these 2 business which got added in 35AD belong to the second category, where you get 100% deduction. What is this 2 types of business? One is the laying of pipeline for distribution of iron ore, and another one is with respect to wafer factory where they're trying to make some integrated circuits. So basically these two businesses got added in 3580. And 3580 has also come up with one more condition, that the assets which are eligible for deduction under this section should be held for 8 years. So if you're not holding it for 8 years, you're selling it within 8 years, then whatever deduction was claimed earlier will become deemed income. So 3580, two business got added and one condition got added. So this is what you need to remember. Further, as we move, Section 37, general deduction got amended. Earlier, CSR expenditure, corporate social responsibility, was eligible for deduction under this section. But from this year onwards, that is from financial year 14-15, it is not eligible for deduction under 37. Then where will you claim? You can claim it as deductions from GTI if it is eligible under Section 80G. So you have to check Chapter 6A. But here under the head BGBP, you will not get any deduction for CSR expenditure. Further, when we move on to disallowances, they have removed one inconsistency. We know the provisions very well. What were the provisions? When it comes to TDS, non-compliance, the condition, the old one was for non-resident, from April to February, we insisted that it should be deducted and it should be paid to the government by 31st March, that is end of the financial year. But when it comes to the month of March, we had time up to 30 April. This was the old story. The expenditure will not be disallowed if you deduct and pay by 31st March for the first 11 months, but for the last month it is 30 April. This was not on par with resident, expenses incurred for resident, this was not the case. So they wanted this to be on par with the resident. So they changed it and they made it like this. So what did they do now? Whether it is April to February or March, the condition is, did you deduct on or before 31st March and did you pay on or before 30 September? That is before the due date of filing return. So now, whether it is non-resident or resident, the provisions are same. In order to disallow an expenditure, you need to check whether TDS is deducted on or before 31st March and whether it is paid on or before 30 September. And this would apply for all the 12 months, April to March. So this is what we are saying. It was disallowed if it was not paid before the end of PY, but now they have changed it to it was deducted and paid before the due date of paying the return of income. So this is the TDS thing. So when you are solving the problem, just focus on one point. Is it deducted before 31st March and is it paid before 30 September? If yes, disallowance is not happening. Another amendment when it comes to disallowance for resident. Now we all know that these disallowances are temporary in nature, right? So what are we saying? That this year if you do not comply with TDS, we will disallow the expenditure and allow it the next year whenever you comply. So here comes the good news. The expenditure is disallowed, but instead of 100%, they are disallowing at 30%. So the government has slashed the percentage of disallowance, which is resulting in lower tax liability. So instead of 100%, it is only 30%. But ideally, this is applicable only when the expenditure is incurred towards resident. So what does that mean? Now we would say, if the expenditure is incurred and TDS is not complied, you need to check towards whom the expenditure is incurred. If it is resident, then the percentage is 30% disallowance. If it is non-resident, then the percentage is 100% disallowance. The percentages have changed, but the condition for disallowance is the same. What is that? It is not paid before the due date of filing the return, whether resident or not. are resident. Only difference is in the percentage. Coming to the next one, presumptive income, section 44AE. Now, till financial year 13-14, we all knew that vehicles are of two types: heavy goods vehicle, other goods vehicle. Based on the vehicle, we said heavy goods is 5,000, other vehicle is 4,500. But from 14-15 onwards, after 5 years, looking at the growth in this logistics industry, carriage, goods carriage, they have revised the presumptive income and they made it 7,500 per month, irrespective of the size of the vehicle. So big or small, now the income is 7,500. Now, as we move on to capital gains. Capital gains, again, there is a possibility that you get a practical question from here. Let us see the amendments. Section 54 is talking about an old asset, which is long-term capital asset, residential house is transferred, and you are investing that money, capital gain, in a new residential house property. And 54F is telling any other asset is transferred long-term and you are buying a residential house property. Earlier, these sections used this word, a residential house, but it was subject to a lot of litigation. People had no clarity, what is a residential house, is it one or more than one? Then amendment has come, which is clarified that it should be a single house. When you are talking about exemption, they want to give intention of the taxman to give you exemption for a single house, not more than that. The size of this single house can be anything, of any size, any value. Value is not the criteria, but the number is the criteria. Only one house is eligible for exemption. And they also came up with another condition, which is saying that the number of houses, one house, where it should be located in India. So prior to this amendment, even if you buy house property across the world, you were eligible for exemption. But from this year onwards, only when you buy it in India, you will get exemption. Coming to 54EC. 54EC, we know it is investment in bonds. Okay, so asset transfer is long-term capital asset, and the investment that you're doing is bond, NHAI bond, Highway Authorities bond, or RECM bond. This section 54EC said that you should invest within 6 months. So from the date of transfer, whenever transfer took place, you have time up to 6 months, or before the due date of filing the return, whichever is earlier, you were having time to invest in these bonds. And this section had a limit, monetary limit of 50 lakhs. Now, how people were doing mischief to enhance this limit? What did they do? So let us say a person has transferred his asset in somewhere on 1st January 2015. He has transferred his asset on 1st January 2015. Then people were doing two investments. Investment one, they did it immediately before 31st March, that is financial year 14-15. They invested some 40 lakhs. And before the due date of filing the return, so let's say it is an individual, and somewhere on 25th July, he invested another 40 lakhs. This 25th July is before the due date of filing return, but it is falling in financial year 15-16. So the investor, what he is doing, he is claiming 40 lakhs plus 40 lakhs, 80 lakhs in total under section 54EC. And he is arguing that this 40 lakhs was invested in 14-15, it was less than 50, and another 40 lakhs was invested in 15-16, which is also less than 50. So individually, both the amounts are less than 50, I should get 80 lakhs as deduction. So to this mischief, this amendment has come. So what is this amendment telling? This amendment is saying, once you do a transfer, when you want exemption and you are investing in the bond, whether it is this financial year or in a subsequent financial year or both the years put together, in total it should not exceed 50 lakhs. So the intention of law is to give you a maximum exemption of 50. So you do not make it 80 like this. subsequent year or both the years, the amount of exemption cannot be more than 50 lakhs. This is the amendment which has come. Now coming to the next important thing, capital gains is based on this. Before we solve a problem, the first step that we do is to find out whether the capital asset is a long-term capital asset or a short-term capital asset. What was the earlier definition? Earlier definition was very simple. So if you focus on it, unlisted securities, others, the criteria to decide long or short was 36 months. Whereas for financial assets like shares, listed securities, units of UTI, mutual fund, zero coupon bond. So I think this is not visible, so let me just put it for you here. What are we saying? The definition of short term or long term, we are discussing the old situation. 36 months criteria was applicable for other assets and listed securities, whereas 12 months criteria was applicable for shares, for this is unlisted securities, listed securities, units of UTI, mutual fund, zero coupon bond. It was simple. So as a student, we said any share, whether preference or equity, listed or unlisted, will be 12 months criteria, long or short. But when it comes to debentures, we said if it is listed debentures, 12 months. If it is unlisted debentures, 36 months. Any UTI, any mutual fund indicates equity oriented or debt oriented is always 12 months. Zero coupon bond is 12 months. Now this got revised. Now what is the new thing which has happened? What is the new law? What did they do? They are saying that out of this shares, listed can be here. Unlisted shares have to come here. So let's say if you are holding shares of a private limited company, then earlier the criteria was 12 months, but now the criteria is listed shares are 12 and unlisted shares is 36 months. Another amendment which happened is mutual fund. If this mutual fund is a debt-oriented mutual fund, then the criteria is 36 months, and if it is equity-oriented mutual fund, then the criteria is 12 months. And we know the difference between equity-oriented and debt-oriented. Equity-oriented fund is a fund where the investment more than 65% goes in the equity market. So now if you quickly observe, when it comes to debentures, it's the same, nothing changed. Listed debentures here, unlisted here. When it comes to shares, listed shares 12 months, unlisted shares 36 months. When it comes to mutual fund, two types of mutual fund. Debt-oriented is 36 months, equity-oriented is 12 months. Zero coupon bond, there is no difference. It is still under 12 months criteria. So this is a very important amendment which has taken place, because when you are solving the problem, you know very well benefit of indexation can be given only for long-term assets, and multiple benefits are eligible for long-term assets. So if you go wrong in step one, that is identifying short and long, then your problem would go wrong. So this is a very important topic. Coming to the next one. Now we are discussing the tax treatment of a debt-oriented mutual fund. So amendment has happened here, but the amendment is not in the favor of SEC. The amendment is not favorable at all. After reading this amendment, SECs are not happy. Why are they not happy? What happened? So let us observe. What is the treatment that is happening? Debt-oriented mutual fund, we know right from the beginning, because this is not risky. People are always attracted towards debt-oriented fund. So taxman has got no role to encourage you, so he doesn't give you tax benefits at all. So what is he telling? He says if you invest in a debt-oriented fund, to decide long or short, the criteria is 36 months, because most of the debt-oriented mutual questions. They are not sure. So criteria is 36 marks. And let's say you are holding it for less than 36 months or equal to 36 months, then we call it short term. And once we call it short term, what are the rates that are applicable? Normal rates would apply. And normal rates, we know 10%, 20%, 30% subject to slabs. But if it is a long-term capital asset, then the tax rate would become 20% with indexation. So now we can say if a client is coming and telling us that we have a debt-oriented mutual fund, we would encourage him to hold it for more than 26 months, make it a long-term capital asset, only then the name would get taxed at 20%. Otherwise, we would pay tax at high rates. But alternatively, if you invest in an equity-oriented mutual fund, which is the favorite, taxman is always encouraging investors to go here because the Indian economy needs lot and lot of equity. So what does the taxman tell us? First important thing, to decide for short, the criteria is 12 months. Because equity-oriented mutual fund is subject to risk, so you need to take a call quickly. You can't keep it for 36 months. So the criteria is 12 months. So long or short depends upon when. If you keep it for less than 12 months, we call it short term. And once we call it short term, the tax rate is 15%. But if you keep it for more than 12 months, again two possibilities. You did the transaction on the stock exchange and you have paid security transaction tax, then the good news is it is exempt under section 1038. You don't have to pay any tax. No, you have not paid security transaction tax. The transaction took place privately. Then in that case, you have option 1, option 2. Option 1 with indexation, pay 20%. Option 2 without indexation, pay 10%. Choices. So here, the only difference is, earlier we never distinguished between mutual fund, whether it was debt-oriented or equity-oriented. It was simple, same provisions would apply. But now, there is a difference. For debt-oriented fund, it became 36 months and equity-oriented fund became 12 months. And two good sections, 1038 and 1001A, are applicable only for equity-oriented fund but not for debt-oriented fund. So if you are solving the problem of mutual fund units, be careful what category of mutual fund it is and accordingly apply the provisions. Now coming to the amendment in IFOS. Now you need to remember both the provisions, the old one as well as the new one. What is this provision? See, we heard about this point in our capital gains. What did we learn? Section 51. We were discussing that there is a situation like this. There's a person who's got a capital asset and he was negotiating the capital asset. In the matter of negotiation, he had taken some advance or some kind of amount. But later on, the sale did not take place, the negotiations failed. On failure, the seller is forfeiting the advance. As per the terms of contract, he can keep the advance with him. He has forfeited the advance. What was the tax treatment you had learned earlier? Section 51 simply said, whenever you forfeit advance, reduce it from the cost of acquisition. This is what Section 51 said. But comes the amendment. Amendment is telling that if advance is received any time from 1st April 2014, that is from financial year 14-15 onwards, then you cannot reduce it from cost of acquisition. That advance forfeited is straight away income from other source. So if you see the difference, earlier the taxman was waiting. He wanted to tax you only when you sell the asset and he reduced that forfeiture from the cost. But now if you observe, he is not waiting. He wants to tax you immediately. Once you receive the money, whether you sell the asset or not, whatever advance forfeiture has happened, it becomes income from other source. You have to pay tax on it immediately. Again, this amendment is not in the favor of the SEC. It is in the favor of the taxman. He is hurrying up to tax us. And now we know there are amendments in deductions also. So if you observe financial year 14-15, three things directly affected the SEC in his favor. One is the basic exemption limit had become 2.5. The next one, 24B limit became 2 lakhs. And third one, ATC limit became 1.5 lakhs. So every thousand. ATC limit earlier was only 1 lakh. They have enhanced it to 1,50,000. But they did not touch the other two sections. Triple C pension plan, LCCD pension scheme. Both are same 1 lakh now. They have not enhanced it to 1.5 lakhs. And we know all three sections put together cannot cross 1,50,000. But to understand these limits, there is a small example. In this case, Mr. X invested 1,20,000 in pension plan of insurance company. Now we know pension plan is covered under section 80CCC. And 80CCC did not get amended. 80CCC is the same old 1 lakh. So even though you have invested 1,20,000, you will only get deduction which is equal to 1 lakh. Next one, Mr. Y invested in new pension scheme, and once again, new pension scheme did not get amended. So even though you are investing 1,20,000, 80CCD is only giving you a deduction of 1 lakh. There is no amendment here. Coming to the third example, Mr. X has invested 1,20,000 in public provident fund, national savings certificate, and life insurance premium. These three belong to ATC, and we know the good news. ATC got revised, and now it is to the extent of 1,50,000. Therefore, deduction you will get entire 1,20,000. 1,20,000 or 1,50,000, whichever is lower. So you will get a deduction here. So if you observe, previous two cases did not get amended, so you are still getting 1 lakh. But here is the amendment, so you got 1,20,000. Coming to the fourth example, a person has invested in pension plan of insurance company, that is 80CCC, and he has invested in public provident fund, ATC. Both the sections put together, he has invested 1.6 lakhs. We know in total, the deduction cannot exceed 1,50,000. So we can give him a maximum of 1,50,000. So this was your deductions. Now coming to the next one, your amendments in TDS. Now what are the sections which got added? 194BA and 194MBA. Now what is this section? 194BA. This is a section which would directly affect the individuals. Why? What is the link? It is discussing life insurance policy. So we know that in ABC you got a deduction for LIC. But what after deduction? At one point of time, either the person has expired or the policy got matured and he receives the money. So we have learned in IFOS that under section 1010B, LIC proceeds are exempt, subject to certain exceptions like key man insurance is taxable, or LIC is also taxable if the premium paid is more than 20% of sum assured, or afterwards 10% of sum assured. So we have to recollect 1010B. So now we have to be very careful. Now what happened? Let's say you have LIC amount. You got the sum assured either on maturity or on death. So now we will first find out, is it exempt under section 1010D? Now be careful here. You have to find out whether it is key man insurance or the premium paid was 20% or 10% of sum assured. Then find out, is it exempt? If answer is yes, then there is no TDS. Alternatively, it is not exempt. That means you are not satisfying the conditions of 1010B. When it is not exempt, then it is taxable. But the problem is many individuals who were in receipt of LIC amount voluntarily were not offering their income for tax. It was taxable, but they did not pay tax either out of lack of awareness or intentionally. They were not paying tax. To check this section 194BA is introduced. What is this section telling 194BA? LIC company or insurance companies, whenever you are paying LIC amount, please find out if it is exempt. If no, then it is subject to TDS. So here, when we are applying this equal to 1 lakh, then there is no TDS. Note, it is greater than 1 lakh, then TDS is attracted at the rate of 2%. So see, what did we do? We are saying it is not exempt under 1090. Then the responsibility is on the insurance company. It is taxable. They have to deduct TDS. But when they are deducting TDS, they have identified two types of policies. Micro life insurance policies, small policies, where hardly the amount paid is less than a lakh. When it is less than a lakh, where is the question of deducting TDS? So no TDS, because at the end of the day, maybe the person's income is less than BM, so for him there is no tax. But alternatively, if the size of the amount is more than a lakh, the TDS is attractive, but luckily the rate is only 2%. So this is what you need to remember. Three lines. It is not exempt under 1090B. Next thing, it is more than a lakh, then the TDS rate is 2%. This is one new section which has come. Now the next section that we are discussing is 194 LBA. What is this 194 LBA? Let us see briefly. There are investors in the market. These investors can be resident or non-resident. They are basically people who have lot of money. So what are these people doing? They are forming a trust. And all the money that they have, they pool into this trust. The name of this trust is called business trust, or alternatively you can also call real estate investment trust. Whatever name you give it, business trust or real estate investment trust. This trust is again floating on special purpose vehicle. What is this special purpose vehicle? It is an Indian company incorporated in India, but the substantial interest or the control or the share capital is with the business trust. The business trust is holding major stake in this Indian company. What is the job of this Indian company? All the money which has come here, this company is supposed to identify real estate companies, projects, and invest in that real estate assets. So indirectly, there are so many companies, ventures going on in India which are executing real estate projects. So this special purpose vehicle will invest money in these companies. And the investment is of two types. They can either invest in the form of debt or they can invest in the form of equity. So they identify some X company, and in that X company they are subscribing to the debentures, bonds, or they are subscribing to the equity share capital of that real estate company. So see, investor ultimately wanted to target this, but for them they cannot go directly. There is a procedure. They all pull the money, keep it with the trust. Trust is incorporating the company, and this company will invest money in, let's say, 5 to 10 other companies. So this is needed because directly the trust cannot do the investment. So trust is only the holding the money, and they gave the job to the special purpose vehicle which is acting like an agent. And this company is indirectly is investing money in another 5 to 10 companies. This real estate assets are so many in now. So this is the chain which is happening. So in this, now we will say that there are two possibilities. If it is debt, then the income that we are discussing, okay, otherwise we will start with equity. If it is equity, then the income that we discuss is dividend. And what is the root? So here we will say real estate company. Okay, that real estate company will pay to special purpose vehicle. Special purpose vehicle will pay to business trust, and business trust will pay to the investor. What are they paying? The dividend. It is passed on. This first transaction is subject to dividend distribution tax. When this real estate company is investing, it is paying the dividend, it has to comply with dividend distribution tax. On behalf of the investors, dividend distribution tax is reaching the government at this stage. Because the first stage got taxed, all the other stages are exempt. They are only passed. simple. This company which has used the equity share capital is paying dividend, and when they are paying dividend, they pay dividend distribution tax to the government, and later on that dividend is passed on. So when it is passed on, all the other transactions are exempt. But if you go to the next situation, the company has taken debt. On the debt is passed on like this: business trust to the investor. Here comes, there is no dividend distribution tax. There is no DDT. When there is no DDT on interest, there is no DDT. This was dividend income, whereas this one is interest income. On interest, there is no DDT. When there is no DDT, then which transaction is taxable? This transaction is taxable. So we want to tax this. Why not the previous transactions? The previous transactions, company paid interest, for the company it is an expenditure, and SPV is only an agent who is taking it and passing it on. Ultimately, that interest belongs to the investor, so it is income for him. So we have to tax it. But here we gave him exemption because already the dividend got taxed here. So because it is taxed here, it is exempt here. But here there is no tax, so this fellow has to pay tax. So when he is taxable, what are the tax rates? It depends upon who the investor is. If he is a resident, then the tax rate is 10%. If he is a non-resident, then the tax rate is 5%. We want to attract investments from non-residents, so therefore we kept the tax rate 5 for them. So to comply with the taxability, TDS has come. So what is this section telling? 194 LBA? 194 LBA is telling business trust is ultimately passing on interest income to the unit holder. Unit holder is nothing but the investor. On that interest income, the business trust has to deduct TDS under section 194 LBA. What are the rates of TDS? The same, the tax rates, resident 10%, non-resident 5%. So as a student, your job is to understand that investors wanted to invest money in India. So how are they doing it? They are floating a trust, trust is floating a company, and company is putting money in the market. End of the day, returns are reaching the investor. If it is dividend, it is exempt, we are not discussing. If it is interest on debt, then it is taxable. So in order to tax it, the TDS section has come. And we have put the responsibility on the trust. You collect TDS and give it to the government. So this is your TDS. And now there is one small amendment in charitable trust and institutions. Actually speaking, charitable trust is a CA final topic. But last few years, there were two exam questions from this area. Especially whenever amendment comes, even though this chapter belongs to CA final, they are giving a question at IPCC level with regard to the amendment. So what is the concept here? Let us see, charitable trust. Understand what is the amendment. In order to understand the amendment, we should actually look at one format. How is a charitable trust paying tax to the government? So I would appreciate if you note down this format. There's a format for computation of income of a charitable organization. So we will start with income from property held under a trust. Next one we would write voluntary donations including anonymous donations, excluding corpus donations. So everything which I am writing here will be explained to you. So just observe, this is your total less anonymous donation, small a, amount received. Okay, so what we will do first, we will finish this, which is taxable at the rate of 30%. less 15% general deduction less application so what we get is taxable income at normal rates okay so this is the format for a charitable organization we all know about charitable organization it is eligible for exemption and it is defined under section 2 subsection 15 it is the one which is carrying out medical relief to poor education general public utility etc and we learned that it has to get registered for enjoying exemption so basically a charitable organization is eligible for exemption then what is this format talking about so let's say if you get a small problem on computing taxable income then you should be able to apply this format and the amendment which has come is hitting this format so let us first understand what happened so we are starting with income from property held under trust so most of the charitable organizations either have house property income or they have some kind of small business setup where they are earning some income but the best thing about that income they want to use it for their charity so that income we are taking along with that every charitable organization is also receiving donations funds from the members general public outsiders donors so voluntary donations including anonymous donation now what do you mean by anonymous donation anonymous donation is a donation which is received from public but the identity of the donor is not on record we don't have a proof of ID we don't have his address proof his bank account details are all missing so basically anonymous donation is a place where a lot of black money is coming into the charitable organization all that black money which is given as anonymous donation identity is not revealed has to be taken care excluding corpus donation see this is a format which is applicable for your revenue receipts corpus donation is your capital receipt what do we do with this corpus donation here the donor has specified that the money which I am giving should be used for construction of building or buying for so and so thing so some specific direction is given by the donor that corpus donation is not a revenue receipt it cannot come here do not take it take all the other donations once the figure is ready remove anonymous donation which is taxed at 30% so see now the best thing to curb the black money we want to control it so what are we telling to the charitable organizations if you don't keep a record of the donor if you don't have the ID address proof of the donor then the drawback is all such donations will get taxed at 30% for you but here also there is a small relief which is coming what is this relief anonymous donations which are taxable at 30% how to calculate anonymous donations received take it here less relaxation given by the taxman what is this relaxation he is saying small a 5% of donations small b rupees 1 lakh whichever is higher can be subtracted from here this balance is getting taxed at 30% so what does this relaxation mean see taxman did not stop here he never said whatever anonymous donation you have received I will tax at 30% he is coming up with small tolerance what is this tolerance he is telling when you are into this activity of charity there are chances that people drop in money and you don't know the identity of the donor so to that extent I'm ready to tolerate but what is that extent he say this anonymous donations can be up to 5% of your total donation so let's say you got some 10 lakhs so up to 5% of that 10 lakhs is allowed or 1 lakh rupees whichever is higher is eligible for relaxation you can remove from here then the balance is getting taxed at 30% so now let's say this is 10 lakhs or assume this to be 5 lakh rupees, and 5% of donation. So assume total donations received by us is 10 lakhs. 5% of 10 lakhs is coming to 15,000 or 1 lakh rupees, whichever is higher. So 1 lakh, and the balance is 4 lakhs, and this 4 lakhs is getting taxed at 30%. This is your anonymous donation working note. Now, how to fit this working note in the main format? So here, when we are talking about less anonymous donation, which one should we take? Prior to amendment, people were taking 5 lakhs. So all of you focus here. When they wanted to remove anonymous donation, because that already got taxed at 30%, so how can it enter into the normal format? We have to eliminate. So when you want to eliminate, people were doing a mistake. They were eliminating 5 lakhs. But observe, even though we have received 5 lakhs, out of 5 lakhs, what is getting taxed at 30%? Only 4 lakhs is getting taxed at 30%. There is a relaxation given. So when 4 lakhs is getting taxed at 30%, you want to remove the amount which is already taxed. So which one are you supposed to remove? You should subtract 4 from here, not 5. So prior to amendment, people were subtracting 5. After amendment, a clarification has come. No, no, that is not the intention. The figure which got taxed at 30%, that has to be removed. So 4 should be removed from here. Then total donations we are taking here. So I told you total donations is some 10 lakhs. So 10 lakhs is coming here. So from 10 lakhs we are removing 4. So indirectly that 1 lakh is still remaining here, and it is subject to the next procedure. You get a general reduction of 15%, which whatever you do, all this, there are no conditions applicable, because we have learned that every charitable organization should spend 85% of its income on charity. 15% general reduction is given. And another thing that we subtract from here is application. Now, what application is this? Just charitable organization is spending money on their purpose, charitable purpose. So whatever spending they do, they subtract here. The leftover amount is getting taxed at normal rates. So in this format, we have understood that out of this 5 lakhs which we receive, anonymous donation of 5, 4 lakh is getting taxed at 30%. The other 1 lakh is entering into the format. Into the format. What format? It is subject to the conditions. What conditions? 15% general reduction we are giving. That means 85% should be spent on charity. Subject to how much you spend, the leftover amount is getting taxed at normal rates. So we, after considering the application, whatever is applied, after considering the application, whatever is left balance will get taxed at normal rates. So this is what happened. It's a very small topic, not very important for you at IPCC level, because as I told you, this is a CFIU chapter. Let's just remember the basics. So by this, we have finished the amendments on direct taxes. So I hope this video, you found it useful. And if you have any queries with respect to amendments or any other topic on direct taxes or indirect taxes, you can always feel free to connect to me either on my website, cakarishma.com, or I have a Facebook page by name CA Karishma, or you can send me an SMS on Facebook. I will always respond to your queries, and thank you so much for subscribing to my video.